Hello, Bobby Torres of Frightbox Recording here to explain to you the top 5 reasons why home studio recordings usually end up sounding pretty bad. Now admit it, when you think of home recording, I'm sure you think of budget, not great sounding productions. That's generally what comes to mind when people think of home recordings. Now, this isn't the reality. You can make amazing, totally professional sounding recordings in your home studio, but the truth is there's still that connotation between bad sounding recordings and home recordings. It still exists, that's just how it is. Even in the modern day, it's still what comes to mind. Now, it's common for people to falsely blame cheap interfaces, improper acoustic treatment, the lack of a console, the lack of outboard gear, the lack of expensive microphones. People generally blame the gear and the actual room you're recording in on why these recordings end up not sounding great. And I'm here to tell you that it's baloney, and there are other reasons why home studio recordings end up not sounding great. And I'm gonna give you the top 5 reasons that I see time and time and time again so you can avoid these mistakes. Number 1 on the list, not getting tones right at the source. So some real world examples that I always see happen are when people don't tune their drums, improper mic placement on their drums, not dialing in good guitar tones at the source, whether it's an amp sim or a real amp, not using fresh strings and not properly intonating their guitars and basses, not using fresh drum heads, just things like that. We're quick to blame things like not having high-end mic pre's, not using outboard gear, but in reality, the things I just previously mentioned, just getting things right at the source, has nothing to do with gear and all has to do with your approach. And that's by far one of the main reasons why most home recordings don't sound that great. Now, yes, this does happen in pro studios as well, especially if you're tracking with like an intern or something like that. But at the end of the day, I see it happen way, way, way more often in people's home studios. So remember, get it right at the source. And reason number 2 why so many home recordings don't turn out great is the lack of pre-production. So because people have their own recording setups, they just dive in and start tracking songs that might not be finished in the first place. There's a reason why when you work with big time producers, they do a ton of pre-production. It makes the recording process so much easier, which in turn will make the mixing process and mastering process so much easier. Now, even though you might be recording in a simple home studio, I don't care if it's just a laptop and a 2-channel interface, you should always do pre-production and flesh out your songs before you start setting up microphones and dialing in tones and going through all the trouble of recording your songs in its finalized state. And believe me, I've made this mistake dozens of times myself. This is why I have a plethora of music that's unfinished, and the stuff that is finished from way back when I started doesn't sound that great. Drum parts that weren't finalized, guitar solos that weren't finalized, vocal harmonies, all of these elements that were never fleshed out and never put into place before I brought my band into the studio to start tracking. So again, take pre-production seriously, even if you're the recording engineer recording in your own home studio. It is definitely worth it. Okay, and this brings me to reason number 3, not taking the time to do the stuff that professional engineers actually do. Now, this has nothing to do with equipment or the fancy room you're recording in. It all has to do with the stuff that we don't want to do. Drum editing, vocal tuning, recording our takes in small sections if our guitar player isn't tight enough. The stuff that sucks, but you gotta do. Now, I found that people are either unaware of these things that pro engineers do or are just too lazy to do them. I was always the lazy guy. But believe me, you will never, ever, ever achieve great professional sounding results if you don't take the time to do the things that pro engineers and producers actually do in the real world, whether they're recording in a budget studio or a multi-million dollar facility. It doesn't matter. It's all about the system and the workflow. So do not skimp over your editing and all the stuff that's not fun to do. It will make or break your productions. Believe me. And this brings me to reason number 4, and I see this all of the time, recording way too many tracks without any intentionality. So in other words, because we have our own home studio setup, you could go insane recording a million tracks that may or may not really belong in the final production. And this is why I always tell people to be very intentional and be ruthless with what tracks they decide to put within their production. Back before DAWs, when engineers were using tape machines and consoles, they had to be very intentional with what they decided to record and use within their mixes. And this limitation was actually a good thing. It helped them develop more solid productions, productions that were clear and had a purpose. In other words, if they recorded a bunch of tracks, they would quickly sum them down because they didn't have the available tracks on the console to work with anyway, or the tape machine. And they had to make sure that whatever was going into the mix really belonged there. Now, when I say this, people often say to me, oh, there's so many great records that have a million tracks, and you are right. But these records were done by producers that had a very clear vision, and they didn't just haphazardly start recording tracks in the studio, especially when they were working in expensive facilities 1970s where time equaled money. And again, this commonly becomes a problem for people in their home studios because time doesn't equal money. They can take all the time they want. That's not necessarily a good thing. So again, be intentional with the tracks you're recording and decide to use within your production, and don't just randomly record tracks just because you can. It will hurt your productions. Okay, and this brings me to reason number 5 why so many home recordings don't end up sounding that great. And it's a simple one. Home studio owners rarely set deadlines for themselves. Much like reason number 4, because time doesn't equal money and you could take as much time as you want, it's not uncommon for people to spend years and years and years on projects that should have only taken a couple of months. Again, I'm speaking from experience. There are projects that I started back in 2008 that I never finished because I either kept adding things, changing things, mixing things over and over and over and over again. But at the end of the day, it did nothing but prevent me from releasing my music or releasing music that just didn't have the same heart and soul in it that it would have had if I had a cleared start and end point. Remember, just because you're working within a budget studio and you don't have all the fancy pants gear, which you really don't need, that big studios have, pay close attention to the workflow, habits, and techniques that pro producers and engineers actually use in the real world. You'll notice they don't endlessly work on records till the end of time. They rarely start albums without doing thorough pre-production. They don't record a bunch of bad sounding sources and expect to fix them later. They don't skip over editing and making sure that they do whatever it takes to make the tracks tight and sound great. And they don't record a billion extra tracks that really have no purpose within the production anyway. So again, when we think of home studio productions, many of us think of bad sounding productions, but at the end of the day, it has nothing to do with bad or inexpensive gear or the lack of room treatment. It usually comes down to user error. And in my opinion, these top 5 reasons are by far the most common that I see over and over and over again. And I've been guilty of them myself. So I want the best for you. I want you to skip over all this crap and get right to making great sounding music. And because of this, I put together a 5-step guide to better heavy mixes so you can achieve better results with the gear you have right now. There's a link to the free guide right below within this video's description. So I'm curious, do you have your own home studio and do you often blame your gear and the room you're recording in for the results that you're achieving that you're not too happy about? Or do you have a home studio and you're absolutely thrilled with your productions and feel that they're just as professional as anything coming out of a pro studio? I'd love to hear your opinion. Leave a comment in the comment section below and let me know. If you found this video helpful, like, comment, subscribe, and share. And do not forget to click the little bell icon so you can be notified every time I upload one of my weekly videos on all things metal and rock production. You can both like and follow me on Facebook and Instagram. Links are in the description below. And until next time, happy home recording.